So now, so far, see what we have discussed, you know, since friction is covered, see, usually we say that if there is no friction, we are taking a pulley. If it's a frictionless, then tension in one side is equals to the tension in other side, right? That has to be there because we want to balance the moment about the rotational axis, right? So now this belt friction application, what we are going to see actually is how the tension will differ on the both sides if we take into account the friction on the body where it is going to be roped in. Okay, so many applications are there. So first example is a capstan, or you can think of a, you know, bollard, we call it. For example, you know, when we are going to anchor a boat or anchor a ship, when it comes to the, let's say, to the, you know, to this parking area, then the person who is actually going to hold it, he has to apply a very small force in order to stabilize the large boats or ships, okay? So tension on the both side will differ in that case. Similarly, we can take a, you know, example of a pulley that is raising or lowering the loads, right? So I can actually apply a very small force to either hold the, you know, weight that is on the other side, or I can even apply a very large force to really bring that weight up. So again, you can kind of guess that there are two conditions here going on, impending motion. The weight that is on the other side can actually tend to go down or tend to come up. So same logic as that of point friction that we have discussed in the morning is going to apply in this case, okay? Similarly, we can also think about some cases where the torque is being transmitted. So we have two pulleys, or let's say one is connected to a motor, where we are actually going to give the applied torque. So motor is giving the torque, right? And that torque is going to be transmitted to a tool that is connected with the other pulley. So that means here, actually, let's say there is another machine tool that is going to be rotated by the applied torque that is coming into play here, right? But in this case, the type of problem that we are going to study is always going to be either constant velocity, let's say, that means uniform motion, such that we can apply the statics. Okay, so we are not getting into any kind of situation where there will be acceleration or deceleration into the body. Okay, just keep that in mind. Similarly, we have, you know, brake problem, band brake problem, where there is a drum here, and then drum is actually connected to, again, some kind of component, and there is a band on top of that is the belt, okay? And let's say this drum is moving at a constant speed, which can be attained, let's say, by applying a certain amount of torque. And then we are going to see that when we are, you know, this belt, when we say that there are tensions, you know, both sides are going to be unequal, that has to balance that torque. So we are actually eventually going to apply certain amount of torque in order to bring the drum into equilibrium in a constant speed. So think like that way, okay? So in all of these cases, we have to first find out that what relationship exists between the tension in one side of the belt with the other, if we take into account the friction in these problems. So remember, now the point of discussion here would be, is that, let's say, I'll just assume that this drum is fixed and there is a belt on the top and we have friction in between. Now what happens, let's say this belt is about to slip to the right. That means just the impending slip is going to happen. If the impending slip is going to happen, which side will have the higher tension? right side. Why? Because if the belt is trying to slip that way, the friction should try to oppose that, right? So there is an opposing force. That means this tension in the right side should be higher than the tension in the left side. So T2 should be always greater than T1 as long as the belt is trying to slip towards the right. So first we have said that it is an impending condition is already established, right? Okay. Now how I am going to solve this problem, relate this, you know, T2 and T1 is as follows. We have already said in the point friction, what is the maximum friction force possible? Mu s n, right? That's the maximum friction force during the impending slip condition, right? So I am going to apply the same rule here, but for a differential element, that means for a small element, I am going to say that that small element is under impending slip, and then I will simply integrate the effect over the contact angle. That contact angle is actually beta, okay? Because friction is happening everywhere. So therefore now, it is also assumed if it is a rotating problem, let's say this drum is actually rotating along with the belt, the speed is reasonably low such that there is no force, the centrifugal force is not coming into play, which is acting radially, okay? So with this assumption, just look at it, isn't that simple to derive a formula that actually gives me the tension between T2 and T1. What relationship exists in terms of what? In terms of friction, coefficient of friction, static coefficient of friction mu s, and the contact angle beta. This is my governing, you know, these are the two things again going to govern the entire friction law. Okay. So let's look at this differential element right here, which is actually at a distance theta and which has an angle of delta theta. Okay. So if I assume the tension in this side is T, therefore on the other side it should be T plus delta T. Okay. Now we simply take the equilibrium of this. Remember here I have the normal force delta N, and I have already invoked the friction law here, which is mu s times delta n, okay? So if I try to take the equilibrium of this, so I do sum of force along x0 and sum of force along y0, okay? Ultimately, we are going to get this one when we eliminate the delta n from this. So ultimate objective will be to just eliminate delta n and get a relationship with delta t, t, and the other parameter, that is delta theta and mu s, so on. Okay. Now when delta theta goes to 0, then this one straight goes to 1, and this parameter right here, that goes to 1, right? So therefore, ultimately I have delta T by delta theta, right? Negative mu s T. Remember, when delta theta goes to 0, the delta T is also going to go to 0, right? So therefore, I have delta T divided by delta theta equals to, let's say, mu s delta T. Mu s T, sorry, okay? So therefore, now we are going to simply apply the separation of variables. That means we are now going to say that dt by t should be equals to mu s d theta. Okay. And therefore, now you integrate it. So we integrate it from theta 0 to beta. And therefore, the integration limit on the other side will be t1 to t2. So t goes from t1 to t2 and theta goes from 0 to beta. We have made already separation of variables. Therefore, ultimately what I have is T2 by T1 should be e to the power mu s beta. Very simple relationship we establish, but that has know, that is going to do unique things for us. So what is it, first of all? Can I compare it with a point friction? Can I compare it with a point friction? It is, see, there is no definite maximum force for the belt friction. That means there is nothing I can call mu s times L or e to the power mu s times beta. But what I can say that at the impending slip, the maximum friction force that is developed is given by the ratio of the torque. T2 by T1 should be equals to e to the power mu s beta. So therefore, for impending slip, T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. If there is no slip, that means T2 by T1 should be less than e to the power mu s beta, period. Okay. So ultimately, we just take this concept into account, and therefore, now interesting facts will come into play. We all know the tension in the belt that pulls, that should be T2, and tension in the belt that resists, that is T1. That means for this belt to slip towards the right, T2 should be greater than T1. Now, if actually this belt slips over the drum, then I cannot say T2 by T1 equals T to the power mu s beta. Again, compare it with the point friction. So I have to say T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu k beta. That is the kinetic coefficient of friction. If there is a relative slip actually taking place between the drum and the belt. OK? No, not necessarily. Velocity, yeah, for the constant speed problem, we'll try to come to that. OK? But in this case, you know, don't think about velocity now. Whatever problem we are going to solve, they should be always statically determinate. See, in friction case, what happens? Point friction, you always create an unbalance, right? There will be imbalance in the system as soon as the barrier is broken. The maximum force is broken, that means you have an imbalance in the system. Then you can think of that there is an acceleration to the system, right? But here, remember all the problems so far you have seen, never we have touched upon that line, that there is actually, you know, imbalance force equals to mass times acceleration. We have never said that. So the component either that we have solved, they are statically determinate, and that they can be solved by the static equilibrium conditions. Okay? So number of problems can be actually solved. Flat belt passing over a fixed cylindrical drum. Ropes or belt wrapped around a post or capstan or pulleys, or belt drives, as I showed, that all of this problem can be solved by this single, you know, friction law, which is now T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta at the, during the impending slip. That means the belt is just trying to slip over the drum, rope, or, you know, drum or whatever it is connected, okay? Now these problems can be best understood by solving, you know, a multiple number of problems with different types of contacts. So again, how we solve the friction problem? We always try to understand, okay, how many number of unknowns I have, and how many number of static equilibrium conditions I have, how many slippage condition I have to invoke, at how many surfaces. Isn't that? That was the basis of solving all the friction problem. Count the number of unknowns, figure out how many static equilibrium condition I have. Therefore, the rest balance amount, that means whatever extra unknown I have, that many contact surfaces have to have to solve this problem. Isn't that the basis? So if you think of the force, from the force perspective, it is very, very simple. But if you take it to the kinematic deformation, that where actually I have to, you know, invoke the friction law, that's a bit complex, right? So now let's look at this problem. So this problem says that a cord, that's a cable, let's say, it is wrapped around twice at A and wrapped around three times at B, and then it is going to go over a barrel-shaped, thing right here. That is a half barrel. And supports a mass of 500 kg. The question is, what is the tension T required to maintain this load? Take coefficient of static friction 0.1 for all surfaces of contact. See, in this case, what happens? First of all, understand like this. I can either attempt to just hold the load. That means this can simply try to come down. This is trying to come down. I'm simply trying to hold the load. Or I want to really pull that load up. That means my impending slip condition is upward. So there is impending slip condition downward, impending slip condition upward. Because remember, why I'm going to impending slip? Because that gives me the maximum numbers. So I have to always assume that I want to break the barrier. That barrier is the friction force, right? Okay, that is at the contact. Now think of it, how many unknowns I have? Let's say this is T1, this is T2, this is T. That means I have three unknowns. So now there is no equilibrium in this case. What it is, basically, I have to have three contacting surfaces. So I have to apply the friction law three times to solve this problem. And that is true, that because indeed, I have three contacting surfaces. We can't see equilibrium. So T2 by T1 equals to mu to the power mu s beta is not an equilibrium condition. It is like mu s n in your friction problem. It is a friction law, okay? Right? So now, what happens in this case? Remember, if I just want to hold the load in this position, I will have to apply small force. If I have to pull it up, I have to apply more force. So that, you know, has to be kept in mind. And we have to, whatever answer we get at the end must follow that logic. It is just by logic, simple logic. Okay, in one case I am just trying to hold, so I don't need any much force, but in another case I am just trying to pull it up, so I need a large amount of force. So now I can definitely go to this with this, you know, part that I have said, that in this case, when the upward impending motion of mass, in that case T must be larger than that of the weight, and when impending motion is downward, that means you are trying to hold the load, then T should be less than mg, okay, right? So this problem would be simple as long as we can calculate all the contact angles. Angle of contact needs to be calculated very fast. So what are the angle of contacts? So in A, it was wrapped around twice, so it is 4 pi in radian. In this case, it is 6 pi. And for this small half barrel, it is actually 0.5 pi over 2, 90 degrees. Those are my contact angles. What are the free bodies? First, I have a weight, right? So let's say this is T2. Then the force will again change at T1. And this is what I want to find. Three unknowns are there. So I will repeatedly apply the friction law, right, in all the contact surfaces to establish the relationship between T2 and T1. So just make sure, first I assume that impending motion is downward for this mass. If the impending motion is downward, then this logic has to follow. Right? Then I can say if the impending motion is downward, then mg must be T2 because this one is going to give me the maximum tension right here in the cable, right? And this will be the smallest, okay, right? So therefore, I should say that mg must be greater than T2, greater than T1, greater than T. The then I am going to, yes, any question? Is that clear? Because I am just trying to hold the load. Therefore, my weight has to be the maximum tension in the cable, right? And the load will be the minimum. Okay, that is one case of it, right? When I count the impending motion downward. Because what is the friction direction in this case? When it is trying to come down, right, then it is always going to be upward. So that means this tension has to be greater than this tension. Okay. So like that, therefore, what I have done here, I have simply applied the friction law. So first, right here, I have said mg divided by T2 must be equals to e to the power 0.1 pi over 2. Just for this particular half barrel. Okay, so this is now my T2 actually, and this is my T1. This is larger, this is smaller. So that thing we have to always examine. Okay, which one gives me the greater tension? That is always going to be T2 in the formula. Okay, so what is shown here, this T2 is not actually the T2 in the formula. Just think about that, because that is not the larger tension. Okay, clear? So probably I should have put a different notation here instead of T2 and T1. We could have taken P1 and P2. That would have been much, useful. Okay, just symbol wise, not to confuse. So now again, now in this capstan, here I have T2 by T1. So this will be the larger side. Again, this will be the smaller side. So I have T2 by T1 equals to this. And right here I have T1 by T equals to this. Okay, so now I have established this relationship. Therefore, I can simply, multiply all of these three. I will get a relationship between mg and t. Okay, so the final answer will come out to be 181 newton. Now let us look at impending motion. Is just upward. So now it is upward impending motion. If it is upward impending motion, then what I have? The tension has to be maximum here and minimum here. And I will go by that rule again. So now I have to reciprocate everything. So in other words, I will just say that instead of saying T by mg, equals to e to the power negative that, I will just say mg by t equals to e to the power minus that one. And that will give me the solution. We can go to the same steps. Logically, it is going to, we can follow the same steps. So ultimately, you will see the final outcome would be that mg by t is equals to e to the power negative 1.05 pi, ultimately, okay? So with that, therefore, I get the tension value. So look at the tension value right here. It is so high. So that means, to just move this, 500 newton load upward, I need a very high amount of force. Whereas just to hold it, I need a very small amount of force. Clear? So what is the condition? So what is the range of T that will give me the equilibrium all the time satisfied? That will be 181 newton to, let's say, 132 kilonewton. So that's the range in which my equilibrium is always going to be maintained. If I am outside, let's say, if I don't apply this force, if I don't apply this tension, it is suddenly going to downward. Okay? So very simple problem. Any question on this? Clear? So that kind of forms the basis, and I'm really comparing with now with the point friction that was studied, okay? So in this problem, we have three pulleys, pulley C, pulley D, and pulley E. Now what is being said that two of the pulleys, D and E, they are locked to prevent rotation. So they are actually locked. Okay, they are fixed. They can't rotate. However, C is slowly rotated. This one is slowly rotated. So what we want to find out, determine the largest weight which can be raised if pulley is rotated. Of course, it has to be clockwise, okay? So remember what is happening, that means the belt and the pulley C, these are actually going together in this case. If we look at the motion of the pulley C, the belt is actually in always contact, in touch, right? It is just rotating like this. Whereas since D and E is locked, what is happening? Belt is actually constantly slipping over those two pulleys. They will take mu k, great, so everyone got it. So this is the key feature here. So what is happening, if we look at the impending slip at C, then that is the max condition I am trying to achieve, right? I am just assuming this is my impending slip condition, right? And here it is going to actually go over the pulley, so that means there is relative slip between the pulley and the belt, okay? So with that, we can quickly draw all the, you know, free body diagrams that are necessary. What are the free body diagrams necessary? Just look at this. WA, T2, these are the two tensions in the cable. So here I have T2, T1, and then you have T1 and 16. Okay. Now when I am invoking the friction law at C, right? So I am assuming in order for to find out the largest weight, right? That means it has to simply try to break the barrier here, the friction force that is in the contact, right? So I have to invoke the friction law there. So remember now in this case, therefore WA must be greater than T. So tension in this cable should be greater than tension in this cable. Why that is happening? By the way, is the equilibrium is violated if I do so? How the torque is being applied? See, I have to always balance the torque that I apply. Don't forget, I am applying a clockwise torque. So in this problem, in part C, I have a clockwise torque. I have to balance that. What is balancing? WA minus T2 multiplied by R. So one is clockwise, another is counterclockwise. So pulley is in under equilibrium. We have already said we are moving it in a very slow speed, right? So in that way, it is maintaining the equilibrium over there, okay? So once I do this, therefore WA is my greater tension side. So WA by T2 is equals to e to the power mu s. Now we have to find this contact angle beta C, which can also be found out, right? What is this contact angle? Just look at here, beta C is going to be 2 pi over 3. Okay. Now in the other cases, these two pulleys, they are actually prevented to do rotation, right? That means what is this? This will be kind of not hinged here, but it is kind of fixed here. There is a fixed support. It can't rotate, right? So that means since it is fixed, it can actually take the moment as a reaction that will balance the torque that is given by the tension in the cable on the both sides. Okay, right? So therefore in this case, now T1 is actually greater than T2. Because what is happening in this case, there is a relative slip. Relative slip of the belt with respect to the pulley. So which way it is slipping? It is slipping this way? Which way is the slip? T1 direction? If the slip is in T1 direction, therefore T1 has to be greater than that of T2. That side tension has to be larger, isn't that? And also, since there is a relative slip, we are going to say that it is e to the power mu k, not mu s, okay, right? So we get that. So therefore, T1 by T2 equals T to the power mu k beta d. Similarly, in this case, we can also find out which way this is actually coming down, right? So this is coming down. Therefore, friction force is opposing. So this has to be my larger side. So 16 is my larger side now. So this is T2, and this is T1 in turn. So this is e to the power mu k beta e. Now this problem is both you have kinetic coefficient of friction as well as static coefficient friction. And in everywhere, equilibrium is maintained, no issue. Static equilibrium is maintained each and everywhere. Okay? So with that, we can just solve again from these three equations, we can simply solve W. Any question? No, there is no, see, in these problems, there is, again, as I said, in the, when I assumed this, no, when I made the assumption, I said that this is always going to be low speed problem. In high speed, there may be a centrifugal force that will actually try to throw the bolt, you know, throw the belt away from the pulley, right? We can't define like that, but there will be an error. Still, you can try to solve this problem using this approach.
Yeah.
There will be only an error in this formula, T2 by T1 equals T to the power mu.
No, we can solve, but there's the same problem by considering the centrifugal tension also.
Yeah, no, I am not saying it can't be done, but this problem, listen, this problem, the objective is that everything is again under static equilibrium.
No, that is all that considering centrifugal tension, then and then only be, it will be in the equilibrium condition also. Then only it will be.
But equilibrium.
That time condition will be.
That is okay. No, you will have a vertical, because vertical equilibrium will be maintained. That we have to figure out. That will give you extra tension in the cables.
No. Yeah.
That is yes. So that is okay. So we are not discussing those problems here.
Yeah.
Because that will be, you know, little bit on advanced side.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, in this equation, the third equation, in that equation for when delta theta is very small, why we are neglecting delta t is zero? Because delta t is the main thing that we are
Now this is a differential, right? T plus delta t over 2. Right. So what is contributing more is T, not delta t. That is a very small component, small fraction. I have to, when I am ignoring the term, I have to simply ignore the term that is associated with the delta t multiplied by things, no? Because that term is contributing very less to the formulas. Okay?
Okay.
In any case, theta equals to zero, if you just say, right, then actually this matches, right, t and delta t. So there is no delta t, okay? And regarding your question, you can do the centrifugal force issue here. So you can put a centrifugal force on the belt, and that will simply change that relationship, okay? Now the important problem that we will discuss now is belt drives, okay? So in a belt drive, again, remember, they are actually belt along with the two pulleys or two drums. They are actually rotating at the same speed. So everything is a constant speed problem here, okay? And here, I have a motor. Let's say this is my driver pulley, so where a motor is applied, so motor is giving a torque, that is an externally applied torque, okay? And once I give this torque, remember, somehow I already, you know, said that transient state is gone, both the pulleys are now at a constant velocity, therefore I am not analyzing that transient state, it is already in the, you know, Newton's first law, okay? So it is in uniform motion. Right, so I will use the static equilibrium conditions. Now what happens if I give a torque here? Which side of the belt will give me higher tension? Sure, if my applied torque is clockwise? The upward one, right? And you can do that very easily using the, you know, equilibrium condition to balance this torque. I must have T on this side greater than this, because I need to have an counterclockwise torque to balance that clockwise torque, right? Okay. Now remember, both are rotating at a constant speed, and I am going to invoke this friction law. T T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta if I want to transmit the maximum torque to the driven pulley, right? So to transmit the torque into the driven pulley, which is my bigger pulley, I have to invoke the friction law, because that ratio T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta, that's my impending slip condition, which states that friction force is now somewhere maximum. Okay. Now there are two different bodies here. How do I decide that where the friction force will reach maximum first? Not only angle of wrap, but also mu s. You have two terms, mu s and beta. They are actually like mu s and n. You have to look at both. It is like your, you know, almost like your Coulomb friction, okay? We have two parameters, mu s as well as n. So we have to see that multiplication of these two, mu s times n, mu s times beta in this case, wherever that is less, right? There the impending slip will happen first. Is that clear? Okay? So now let us draw all the free bodies, and that will give a very good perception as well that how the equilibrium is maintained both at the belt as well as at the drum, at the pulleys. So therefore, what I am going to do, I am simply going to take the belt out. So what is shown here, belt is taken out, and I have shown the friction force here. So this, remember, this side is a higher tension side, right? This is my higher tension side. This is the driver pulley where the motor is connected. So there is an applied torque. That applied torque is shown by M. That is a clockwise torque given. Okay. To balance that, I must say T2 minus T1 multiplied by R should be equals to this M, right? So I must get a counterclockwise torque. Now, how the friction is happening internally? It will simply oppose this tension. So I have shown the friction here, right, on the belt. And on the pulley, it is simply going to be reversed as per Newton's third law. Just look at the equilibrium of the pulley itself, how the pulley is driven, actually. I am applying a torque, right? That torque is simply balanced by the friction force. Right? Torque due to the friction force is balancing the applied torque. Now, when I glue these two, belt as well as, you know, the pulley, when I glue that, then I don't see the friction force at the contact. So I say, okay, T2 minus T1 times R equals to that applied torque. Similarly, for the driver pulley, I have the same situation. For the driven pulley, that is being driven. How it is driven? It is actually driven by the friction force. Again, same situation, right? Okay, so we have T2 here, because this tension has to be same tension, so T2, T1. Now this T2, T1 is going to get this kind of friction force, which is actually rotating the drum. This friction force is going to rotate the drum. And what is this M1 shown? M1 is something that is coming from the machine tool back to the pulley. That is as per again Newton's third law. Because pulley is going to give a clockwise torque to the machine tool that is attached, and machine tool is simply going to give that back to the pulley. That's the equilibrium, you know, of everything in this problem. Okay, so ultimately the torque that is being transmitted is going to be equals to T2 minus T1 multiplied by the radius of the big pulley. See, the problem is very simple, but when you want to draw the free body diagram, as I said in the very first day, that every time we should tell students, you think of it in terms of each and every free body diagram that presents in that particular problem. And everything will be clear, crystal clear. There is no ambiguity here. Yes.
That radius of the pulley is given as 25 centimeters.
Just don't worry about this. I mean, I am not looking at number. This 0.2 is coming from that pulley. That was the driven pulley. Okay. 0.2 meter is given. Don't look at the number, just say R, okay? Don't worry, all right?
Okay, it is 2.
Whatever, that's okay. Yes.
Anything? The direction of this pulley M1 will be, I think,
friction. Will be clockwise.
Which one?
This pulley is rotating in a anti-clockwise.
This is not rotation. There is nothing called rotation in statics.
So,
there is always force. What I have shown here is a force. It's a moment I have written here.
So the direction will be in the
direction will be clockwise.
Direction will be clockwise.
It can rotate clockwise, but what is happening, that machine tool is giving the torque back to the pulley. That's how we show the free body diagram. It is Newton's third law.
Yeah.
So the pulley is giving the torque this way, clockwise, as you see,
yeah,
to the tool. But when we apply the Newton's third law, then reaction is coming back to the pulley. Okay?
This is the effect of that.
Yes. So this is the effect of that. So that tells me that everything is under static equilibrium. It is a constant speed problem. Don't forget. Okay? Now here is the question. If there is a slip, then it is in dynamic problem. Okay? Then I have to bring in one is accelerating, one is decelerating. Think of this way. This is a very simple problem. Now question is, why I am invoking the friction law in one surface? What was the deal in the morning session? Why I am invoking the friction law in one surface? In this case, I said that I am going to invoke the friction law in one surface. Why did I do that? It is a multi-body problem, right? Why both friction law is not invoked in both the pulleys? That is, in terms of force, it's very easy. As I said, you can count the number of unknowns. So the problem will be given like this. Look, I want to find out T2 and T1, right? Let's say I give you applied torque. I have two unknowns. I need two equations, right? Period. What are my two equations? One is the static equilibrium equation that is coming from the torque balance. What is the other equation? Friction law, T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta. Right? Now that can only be applied at one surface, not both surfaces simultaneously. Is that clear? Remember, I have two unknowns here. I need two conditions. I have only one static, you know, equilibrium condition to solve for in this case, because both pulley will do the same thing. Okay? Right? Now what happens? I am applying it only the friction law at one contacting surfaces. Although there are two contacting surfaces here, right? Now, why it is like that? Can you think of it? What happens when actually the belt tends to slip? Kinematically, what happens? Not really. Then one will see what happens. System will be disturbed. One of these, remember, what happens in this case, for example, the motor, the pulley that is connected with the motor, that is actually going to, let's say, because beta is less, let's say mu s is same, let's say mu s is same, beta is different. So this one has a lesser beta, therefore, the impending slip will happen at that pulley, right? Impending slip will happen with that pulley. Which direction pulley is trying to pull, slip? That will be along the T2, right? Okay? Now, as soon as that friction barrier is broken, what happens really? This one is going to be disturbed, totally disturbed. There will be unbalance. There will be a change in speed suddenly. Isn't that? Because remember, this one is still intact. This is still intact. This one is going to get the imbalance. This is actually going into dynamics. So this will either, you know, you can think of that there is an infinitesimally small change in the angular speed. So now you have a relative change in the speed between the two. Now you think of this problem this way. I have one fixed pulley, let's say. I have one fixed pulley, and one of these is slowly rotated, where the belt is actually intact with the pulley, what happens? Think of it, one is fixed. I am rotating one slowly. That means this is actually, now what I'm looking at, relative difference between these two. Because I have said that there is always relative change is going to happen, relative change in the speed, right? So I said there is a delta omega somewhere. Now I am locking one of these. That means I made the, you know, rotation is not as if happening here, that is zero, omega is zero, another is simply delta omega. Where, you know, that for what is happening, one is actually rotating with the belt. In other one, it is actually slipping against. See the point? That means there is an actual slip is taking place in one of the pulleys, not in the both. One pulley is belt is already attached, it is rotating, but the other pulley is actually not rotating because there is a delta omega difference. Can you think of that way? As I said, kinematically, if you want to think, no, but we tell that to students all the time, also try to think hard in terms of kinematically. Because that tells you in the friction problem immediately that why I am really getting one contact surface in this case, why not two? What is happening? Okay, right, is that clear? So therefore, now this problem, we can take it forward. So look at the way problem is imposed here. So I have a flat belt connects pulley A, which is a driver pulley. So similar problem I'm really discussing. This is my driver pulley, this is the driven pulley. What is being said that knowing that the maximum allowable tension in the belt is 600 newton. So one tension is given, right? And we are trying to find out, determine the largest torque which can be exerted by the belt on pulley A. That means how much torque is being transmitted at the pulley A, right? Okay. So in this case, remember, therefore, my unknown is what? In this case, what is unknown? T1. T2 is given, T1 is unknown. That means I don't get into even the business of equilibrium, doing the equilibrium. I just say that where the friction law needs to be invoked. So I just make use of the friction law. Because I know already that all the equilibrium is taken care of. So I have one unknown in this problem, and I just invoke the friction law, but that automatically if the problem is self-consistent, then I must find out there is indeed one contacting surface in the body. In the multiple body system, okay, right? So in this case, now we can say that so the process will be very simple. First, we identify that which pulley will have the impending slip first, and we have already answered that this is going to be, you know, the pulley where the impending slip will happen because mu s beta is less. Right? We can calculate that, right? Okay, so mu s beta, if you calculate the contact angle, this pulley has a lesser contact angle. So B will slip first. That is the first thing. Second thing that we want to find out is the maximum torque in one side of the belt of pulley B. Because what is given? Maximum tension is already given. So which side is that? That is going to be? This one that already we have discussed, so that is also given. So now you just invoke that friction law, T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta, okay? Problem is solved, you get the T1. Now you prove conversely that T2 by T1 is indeed less than e to the power mu s beta for the other pulley. I have to prove that, right? If nothing is violated, if my logic is correct, everything is correct, then I can actually show that pulley A, for the pulley A, T2 by T1 should be less than e to the power mu s beta in order for it not to slip, the belt not to slip over the pulley. Okay? So I solve the problem, I get the T1, right? Once I get T1, problem is solved. I am trying to find out the torque transmitted, that is actually T1. T2 minus T1 times that radius of that pulley, right? And I can also check, so this is the last part is really the check, where I said that mu s you can solve for that pulley, because you know already T2 and T1 ratio, right? So there you can solve actually mu s, that mu s should be less than what is given. Is that clear? That's how you also solve the friction problem. Think of that way. That is what I said, that friction problem, you know, as long as the mechanics is concerned in the first year, very simple, number of equation, number of unknowns, then you figure out how many extra unknowns I have. If the problem is self-consistent, you must have that many contact surfaces where you have to invoke the friction law, period. Problem is solved. Now, if you can think out which surface actually, you know, undergo the impending slip, that we have to deal with the kinematics, actual kinematics, and that is not that, you know, simple for a first year kid to absorb, okay? They have to do a lot of, you know, analysis, all right? So let's say this one is already solved. I'll just show you the, you know, final thing here. So basically I have applied T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu s beta, and I get the T1. So T1 is solved, T1 is 355 Newton. Okay, so pulley B was under impending slip. Aap kar liya, theek hai, very good. Dekhte hain. So moment torque, you know, that is transmitted, that is going to be 48.92. Okay, that's the torque I am trying, that's the, you know, torque that is being transmitted to this pulley, that is the driven pulley. And then we have showed that indeed there is no slip in this pulley, that is the driven pulley. Okay, there is no slip. You can find out T2 by T1, that should be less than equals less than e to the power mu s beta for that pulley, okay? Or the friction value you can calculate, coefficient of friction value you can calculate, that is should be less than what is given, right? Whatever way. Is that clear? Done? Okay. Now we are going to take an example of a band break, okay? So as I said, that the main point here is that drum is actually rotating, and we are trying to, you know, make this drum to be rotated at a constant speed. So the drum is constantly slipping over the belt that we have. And once we adjust this P, okay, so we have to find out what is the P such that a particular torque is achieved. That means there is a particular angular speed. So that means I am controlling the angular speed based on the force that is being given, the P. So there is a relationship between P and the angular speed. So now here what is said is that that angular speed is now controlled by the torque that is being applied. So angular speed is directly taken care of by that applied torque. So that means what would be my P such that that particular speed is achieved, okay? So that is the, you know, basic problem that we are going to discuss. Now again, I would like for you to kind of think about it in terms of first, whether it's a statically determinate problem, how many unknowns really have I'm in my problem, okay, and how do I solve it? So that's the most important thing, okay? Is it now statically determinate if we make those assumptions? It's a rotating at a constant speed. I do apply a torque, right? And basically, I'm trying to find out what the P is, okay, to maintain that speed. Remember, there is a relative slip between the belt and the drum. That is all the time slipping. So we have to use e to the power mu k beta, not mu s. There is no static coefficient of friction. So just think of the, let's say we think about the number of unknowns here. How many do we have? Total 5 unknowns, right? So can we solve all of this? Remember, there is a pin, so 2 reactions here. These are the 2 tensions, 4, and this is also unknown, 5. What is my static equilibrium condition? that is actually the torque produced by the tensions in the belt that is going to balance the torque that is applied, right? That is in equilibrium because it is in constant speed problem. So that's the equilibrium part, right? Then lever has this lever A, B, C will give how many equations? Equilibrium equations? 3 equilibrium equations. So total 4 ho gaya, right? And then we have to apply the friction law here, right? So friction law is T2 by T1 equals to e to the power mu k beta. Is the approach is clear to everyone? I have total 5 unknowns. I have one lever that will always give me 3 equilibrium conditions, right? One is coming from the equilibrium of the drum. There is one static equilibrium, so total 4 equilibrium I am having. Plus, I am using the friction law because there is a relative slip between the belt and the drum all the time. Okay? So if we do that way, then we can now what is interesting, that drum is, you know, there are two different ways we have to solve. First, the drum is rotated clockwise. If it is rotated clockwise, then we solve for the P. Now, if the drum is rotated clockwise, then we have to make sure that which side of the tensions is higher. Okay? So that will be A side. So A side of the tension is now higher and B side is lower. So my T2 by T1 may TA by TB. So it will be TA by TB equals to e to the power mu k beta. Okay? So as such, very simple problem, and we can always correlate this with the, you know, common friction problem, point friction problem that we solve. So that is the approach actually for all the friction problems. So we could see the, you know, now the free body diagrams. Considering that it is rotating clockwise, we are applying this torque. This is the applied torque on the drum, right? If this is the applied torque, then we have the tensions TA and TC. This is meeting at TC. So there is a TC here. Okay, now when it is rotating clockwise, TA should be greater than TC to balance that applied torque. Then we look at the equilibrium of the lever. So we have two reactions, BX and BY. Okay, TA, TC, and P. So simple problem as such, but make sure that we understand all the steps here. Applied couple or torque is 125. Okay. So we can do the equilibrium. So take moment about E for the drum. So this is the equilibrium of the drum. So we get a relationship between TA and TC from here. Right? Okay. Then what else? If I solve TA and TC, then what I can do? I can simply take a, I can simply come to the lever and take a moment about B. See, I can solve all the unknowns, not an issue, but here my target, you know, unknown is just to find the P. But to do so, I have to find first TA and TC. Right? Okay? So we solve that. For the slip in belt, which is already happening, there is a relative slip between the belt and drum. So TA by TC equals to e to the power mu k, that is already given. And the contact angle is actually 7 pi by 6, 90 plus 30. Sorry, 180 plus 30, right? Okay. So we get TA and TC based on these two equations. Okay, and once we know the TA and TC, then we can move on to the equilibrium of the lever. So we go to the equilibrium of the lever. So we take the moment about B. Since TA and TC is already found, so take the equilibrium and moment about B to solve for P. Clear? The approach is clear? Any question on this? Okay. So TA, TC is found. So the next step that is remaining is simply we take the lever here and take the moment about B to solve for P. Okay. Then we do the other way around. So now it is said if it is rotating anti-clockwise, then what is P? So then we just reverse the T2 and T1, right? So that has to be reversed. So in the second case, I will just flash the solution. As such, there will be no change, just the interchange in the TA and TC, okay? So just TA and TC will interchange, nothing else. Whatever we found from the previous one, just interchange that. And then again, solve for the P. So that P will be 9.41. Okay, so now I think any question on the belt friction. So we have basically covered all the problems that I had shown in the first slide. Actually, all the applications that are possible. We have lowering load, or maybe take the load upward. Then we have belt drive. We have band break. Okay, so more or less that is what is covered in here in our course. Thank you.